الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ذي الملك والملكوت، ذي العزة والجبروت. الحمد لله حي قيوم لا ينام، عزيز لا يضام، قهار لا يرام. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. أما بعد، يقول الباري سبحانه وتعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. You who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and die not except on a state of Islam. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, bestow upon us the gift to die on a state of Islam. Allahumma ameen, ya Rabbil Alameen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith narrated in At-Tabarani, says, لَيْسَ شَيْءٌ خَيْرًا مِنْ أَلْفٍ مِثْلِهِ إِلَّا الْإِنسَانِ. There's nothing that is better than a thousand things of a thing like it, except for the human being. In this meaning of the hadith, لَيْسَ شَيْءٌ خَيْرًا مِنْ أَلْفٍ مِثْلِهِ. If you take anything, subhanAllah, and you compare it, cannot be a thousand times better than the same thing, than the thing that from its own kind, except the human being. In the human being, one can be better than a thousand person. One can be better than a thousand person. This is what the Prophet ﷺ said. And you cannot find it in any of the other creation. There's nothing that can be better than its own kind a thousand times, except for the human being. Now in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching us and instructing us about something great, which is, there's the ability and the strength and the power within every human being that they can activate for the sake of the good. And for this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned in many places in the Quran, for example, in Surah الأنفال، الله سبحانه وتعالى قال: إن يكن منكم 20 صابرون يغلبوا 200، وإن يكن منكم 100 يغلبوا 1000 من الذين كفروا. الله سبحانه وتعالى said in Surah Al-Anfal, when it comes to the battle, if it might be 20 among you who are patient, they can overcome 200, and 100 they can overcome, but they are patient. 100 they can overcome 1000. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, there is weakness in you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made now the double, which is mean, let's say, the believer, when we think about this, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructing us such a thing, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us in the Quran, which is to motivate the believer by knowing yourself that you have a true power inside you that you can activate, and then you can make yourself better than who you are now up to 1,000 times, subhanallah. In the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, 10 times. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he sent Amr ibn al-As to Egypt, and he sent with him 4,000 soldiers. So Amr ibn al-As, he asked Umar, he sent to Umar to needing more reinforcement. So he sent him 4,004. He told him, those four, every one of them is equal to 1,000, following the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we have a 4,000 times 3, like 12,000. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, there is no way for a soldier, an army of Muslim of 12,000 soldiers will be defeated, because they are few in number. Which is mean, like, if the army that they are facing them is far, in number, more than them, if the Muslim are defeated, not because they are less in number, because there is another problem, which is it might be their iman, it might be their boasting, it might be something, but it's not the number, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. Why? Because if you have sabr and you have such a thing. In another hadith, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was with some of his companion in a home, and he said, everyone should, have a wish. So one of them, he said, قَالَ أَتَمَنَّ لَوْ أَنَّ مِلْأَ هَذِهِ الدَّارِ دَرَاهِمَ فَأُنْفِقُهَا فِي سَبِيلِهِ. I wish that the you know, this house is filled with silver, I will give it in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll spend it in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other one, قَالَ أَتَمَنَّ لَوْ مِلْأَ هَذِهِ الدَّارِ ذَهَبًا أُنْفِقُهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. I wish that this house is full of gold, I spend it in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'll donate it in the sake of Allah. Umar, he said, وَلَكِنِّي أَقُولُ, but me, I say, أَتَمَنَّ لَوْ أَنَّ مِلْأَ هَذِهِ الْبَيْتِ رِجَالًا مِثْلِ أَبِي عُبَيْدَ بْنُ الْجَرَّاحِ وَمُعَاذِ بْنُ جَبَلْ وَسَالِمْ مَوْلَى حُذَيْفَ أَسْتَعْمِلُهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. I wish that this home is filled with men like Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, like Mu'adh ibn Jabal, like Salim Mawla Hudhayfa. All of them, I use them in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Umar here emphasizing on the power of the human being, on the power that they can have for goodness, on a power that you have the ability to multiply it. Therefore, if you're looking at such a thing, the believer is not seeking the power to be arrogant or boastful, but this power that if you double it, you're going to help yourself not fall into laziness, not fall into cowardness, not fall into failure. And all such a thing makes someone, subhanAllah, to reduce the quality of the iman in his heart that is leading to actually neutralize the iman. So therefore, the believer, he is requested and in necessity to be striving truly to double that effort, to double that power that he already have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you, you have this power. You have the strength within you. It is residing within you, activated to help yourself being driven better to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thinking of it as a necessity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or necessity for the believer to raise or to gain the, or to attain the way of the ihsan. Now, we have said it many times before, attaining the level of the ihsan, which the Prophet ﷺ defined it to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you see him, and if you don't see him, he sees in you, he sees in you subhanahu wa ta'ala. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and attaining the ihsan is one thing, but to be striving on the path of the ihsan is totally different thing. Attaining the level of the ihsan, it is truly in a way fadl min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whoever attained that, he will be like gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So someone who will not get to that level of ihsan, does not, he's failing or he's doing something wrong. However, being on the path of ihsan, striving to get to the ihsan, is an obligation of the believer. Why? Because it's going to activate in you all those elements in you to help you be driven toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If not, what you're going to be, subhanAllah, all our system, you're going to be, you know, invaded by that laziness, but that, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam qala, cowardness. That's why in a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam qala, allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan wa min al-ajzi wal-kasal wa min al-jubni wal-bukh. And all of them are connected. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from the anxiety and worrying, min al-hammi and sadness and grief. And I seek refuge, Ya Allah, from being incapable, from being failing, from being, you know, greedy, from being lazy, from being coward. And all of them, subhanAllah, are connected to each other. So the lazy person is easy to become coward, and the coward is easy to become greedy, and the greedy is in a situation of worrying, and so on, subhanAllah. So to activate that power that you have in you is actually, it is a necessity for the believer. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling you that you have the ability to be like better than 1,000 person. And then again, not in a way to be arrogant or to be violent, but in a way to activate that power to help you be a better traveler to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more secure and safe in the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are actually the elements who help us to activate it? What are the elements to help us to activate this power that you have inside you, that it dwells inside you? That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, you can be such a person. And such a person, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said, قَالَ الْمُؤْمِنُ الْقَوِيُّ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَأَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِ الضَّعِيفِ. The strong believer is, for Allah, in the sight of Allah, is better and dearer to Allah than the weak believer. And in all of them is good. Now, what does it mean here, strong? Strong not in muscles, not strong like in the bodybuilding that he has. No, strong in power of the heart, strong in his intention, strong in his azima, in his willpower, in his dedication, in his commitment, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's dearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the one who getting on the path of laziness and so on. So what are these two elements that help the believer to activate this power inside us? Every one of you has two elements which are al-imanu and al-iradatu. Al-imanu, which is of course the faith, your iman, which is give you the base of your action, the base of your vision, the base of your path, and so on. And then the al-iradatu here is that willpower, that you know engagement, that commitment, that fervor, that zeal, who go to help you, to motivate you to act. Now, if you're going to put these two in practical way, I need the iman, and what I need else, I need the irada, the willpower, the zeal that we need to have, the high spirit who going to engage us into the action. These two elements are in a practical way called, in a very simple way, prayer and sabr, prayer and sabr. Prayer and sabr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this reason, he said to the believer, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Oh, you believe, help yourself, observe, help yourself, comfort yourself, elevate yourself, make yourself, you know, be more firm on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with patience and sabr. With patience and salah. So the patience give you the constancy, and the prayer increase your iman. Increase your iman. So if you think of the patience in a few words, what is the patience for us? And what is salat for us? Because the salat is the heart of the iman. The salat is the backbone of the Islam. The salat is what maintain and safeguard your relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without salat, there is no iman. As a matter of fact, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no salat, there is not actually iman. قَالَ الْعَهْدُ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمْ. The pledge or the covenant between us and the non-believer is the salah. Whoever who lives the salah is like he's not a believer. Therefore, the salah is that heart core of the believer that maintain his status, his identity, maintain his iman. And the sabr comes to play, subhanallah, as very important. The problem that we have some concept among, you know, the community or among the Muslim today to look at things the way that they want them to be. So only we think of the sabr and patience, only something that is, you use it only when you have a problem. There is difficulties, then we need sabr, patience. When the patience is actually an element that is required for every action in your life, and especially for the ibadat, for the worship. You need patience in the salah to have khushu'. You need patience in the difficulty to not complain. You need patience in fasting so you can remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more. You need patience with your family, with your children, so you better educate them. With your family, to better listen to them. So the patience is a part of the iman, is a part, an element that is, subhanAllah, incorporated inside the iman. So when we think of the patience, something, and subhanAllah, an outside element, an independent element, we use it when we have a problem, that actually we are not helping ourselves with the patience that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, all you who believe, help yourself, or observe the patience and the salah to help yourself and have this, the firmness on the iman. As for the salah, subhanAllah, the salah, we mentioned the hadith, a very scary hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam last week, the one who does not maintain and safeguard and observe the salah, he will not have the light, he will not have the evidence, and he will not be saved. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said he's going to be resurrected with Fir'aun, or with Qarun, or with Haman, or with Ubay ibn Khalaf. So everyone who is busy in his life, as we have said, with politics, or with power, or with business, or with money, he's going to be one of them, because one of them, every one of them, is leading into his field, in the field of wealth, love of the world, the other one in the field of the power, and so on, but he's been fully distracted from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, the salat, for the believer, need to be regarded as the most important action in his life. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the preserving and safeguarding the salah in the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun, who are the successful believer, those who find, you know, they are, you know, focusing in their salah, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Then in the end, the Sidh قَالَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِذُونَ. And they safeguard it and they maintain the salah. And the same in Surah Al-Ma'arij, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned one of the characteristics of the human being to be a complainer. The human being, when he has, subhanAllah, some evil touch him, he will be complaining and cursing and so on. And any good that touch him, you know, he will be like, you know, holding. He does not want to give, share, and greedy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make exception only for one category of people. قَالَ الْمُصَلِّ. And he didn't say the believers. He said al-musallin, which is like, subhanAllah, the belief comes to find its center, its core into the salah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, قَالَ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُضِيعَ إِيمَانَكُمْ. Allah is not going to waste your iman. And the iman in this ayah referring to the salah after the qibla was changed from Bayt al-Maqdis to Makkah al-Mukarramah. So here, the salah, when you look at it as the core of your identity, as, you know, the backbone of your iman and the backbone of your deen. So if we do not preserve and safeguard our salah, so it's like, you know, we letting ourselves distracted and distance ourselves from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to gain that power that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us that you have it and you can be as strong as a thousand human being, strong in heart, strong in motivation, strong in zeal, strong in racing, strong in contributing in this, in the well-being of the whole universe. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching us. Therefore, you have to activate these two great action of worship, the salah and the sabr. As for the salah, we continue how to preserve it. The salah is preserved by taking care, you know, preserving and observing to pray it on time. The salah, you have to maintain its pillars, its wajibat, to take care of the salah, to establish the salah, to not only pray, to establish the salah, which is becomes like one of the factors into your daily life to manage your time. The salah help you, subhanAllah, to and guide you and give you the tranquility and so on. So the salah eats the heart of your day as it is the core of your own system. So therefore, if someone will not do such a thing, he will be, subhanAllah, far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find people praying as a form, but not praying with the heart. And those people, they will not be able even to subhanAllah, to encounter or to stand against any of the difficulties. So what do you think about, you know, multiplying the effort or your power that you have inside you to help yourself be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more firm and stronger into your journey of this existence? One of the Arifin saying something very beautiful and nice. So when it comes to the salah, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, qala ash-shuru'u bil-ilm. When you think about the salah, how can we safeguard our salah? How you have these four elements into your mind to safeguard them, you know, to help yourself maintaining a good salah in your day and inshallah all the time, because to be constant on the salah and to be like firm on the salah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that's of the requirement of the success, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in both Surah Al-Mu'minun and in Surah Al-Ma'arij specifically, and many other ayat in the Quran. Now, to qala ash-shuru'u bil-ilmi, ash-shuru'u bil-ilmi, it's a beautiful word. Qala ash-shuru'u bil-ilmi, wal-qiyamu bil-haya, wal-ada'u bil-azama, wal-khuruju ma'al-khawf. When you think of your salah, there is with these four elements. And this, dear brother, respected sister, we are mentioning this as first to change some of the concept that we have adhered to without really understanding, and we have, subhanAllah, inherited by culture or by, you know, just listening. These are how we need to perform our salah and how to need to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you do so, then that power inside you is going to be activated and you're going to be a totally different person. You see, always people, they talk about the new me and things and about, you know, do this and objective, and they make a million of objective and they end up doing nothing. But the believer, subhanAllah, you know that you have a power inside you. You have a strength. You have, subhanAllah, such an engine inside you, which is not working at all. So if you do this simple activity, if you be mindful, then you're going to change yourself. And when you change yourself, it's going to be better for you, the better about the people around you. You correct yourself and you correct your environment and you correct, you know, the people around you. So the fifth thing, قَالَ أَشْرُوعُ مَعْلِيلٌ. Like when you start, you have to have knowledge. What is this knowledge? You are standing to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala fa'alam annahu la ilaha illallah. Know that there is no God except Allah. And then ask Allah for forgiveness. You don't ask for forgiveness without first thinking about the one that you're asking forgiveness from. So when you're standing, whom are you going to stand before? Are you going to stand before the president or king? You are standing before the king of the kings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qala ashuru'u bil ilmi. ثم القيام بالحياة. When you stand with sense of modesty, and you are shy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And being shy from Allah is very important as a quality for the believer, because you don't want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see you thinking or subhanAllah distracted by things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one who's looking at you. How can a believer be distracted from the King of the Kings? So when you are have this haya, when you activate this haya, this modesty, this sense of shyness, you are shy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to see you in the best position as someone standing before an elder. Then قال والأداء بالعظمة. And when you perform your salah, you perform it with the veneration, glorifying Allah. You are in ruku', venerating Allah. You are in sujood, glorifying Allah. You are in qiyam, you are making hamd Allah with your heart. And then when you leave the salah, you leave with fear. Why? Because you don't know if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gonna accept it from you. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the salah, Ya Allah, forgive me, Astaghfirullah, 3 times. And that's actually to empower in our heart that humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is help you to activate that engine of power that you have inside you. And this is here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith that I have mentioned, qala, the strong believer is better in the sight of Allah and dearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the weak one. And then he said, qala, ihrus ala ma yanfa'ak. Listen to this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be eager and have the commitment and get to what help you, what is going to benefit you. Ihrus, I mean have that commitment, have that eagerness to do whatever is going to benefit you. Ihrus ala ma yanfa'ak. This is what, wasta'in billah. So you have something is going to help you on the path. Then qala ista'in billah, invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His help to fulfill it. قال ولا تعجز. Do not fail. Do not be incapable. Do not be lazy. Do not be in a way like, you know, being like subhanallah, someone who's like dormant and does not want to act. ولا تعجز. ولا تعجز. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم telling you this. فإن أصابك شيء. In your path, if something happened to you, so you say قدر الله وما شاء فعل. This is the decree of Allah, and whatever Allah will happen is happening. ولا تقول. And do not say, oh, I wish I did this or did this, because he said, if will open for you the gates of the action of the shaitan. So this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us this. Now, in a few words, the salah and the sabr. What is the action that bring them together to give you the strength when you get to the action? It is the tawakkul, the reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when we talk about the reliance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what it means, the reliance? Also another concept that many of us, they, you know, adhere to it or comprehend it not into the right way. What is the reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The reliance on Allah, the tawakkul on Allah, is the gate to the action in the physical world. You have the iman in your heart, and you have the ability, you have the sabr. When you go to sleep, you have both iman and sabr. But when you're going to act, subhanallah, that starting the action, that what you're going to ignite the worship of the tawakkul. So the tawakkul, it is, subhanallah, the key for all the action in our life. Indeed, actually, we cannot do prayer without the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot do anything of the action of worship, indeed, without the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, the tawakkul have few aspects that we would like to summarize, inshallah, in very, you know, a few words. The first aspect in the tawakkul for the believer, he has a situation, he has a quality, he has the trait of the believer to not invoke in his life or think of miracles or think of supernatural things that is going to help him in his life. That's not the believer. We do not rely on miracles. We don't say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send me the angels to help me. Or people, subhanAllah, they will seek in fortune teller to see, to know their future. Or some of them, because of their weakness of the heart, they will consult with the sorcerer and magician and things. This, it's haram. That really kills the heart. That takes the iman from the heart. So the people who think of miracles, the people think of supernatural things, the people who think like over thinking of the barakah, that everything, inshallah, has a barakah in it, without reflecting on it, that is going not to help us. That's not the believer. The believer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give you a miracle. It is in your iman. And your iman is able, is activated the right way, is going to make you stronger than 1,000 human beings. So what do you want more than that? And people, subhanAllah, being lazy, failing, consuming themselves with worrying and anxiety and grief, and they are waiting for a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to happen to change their condition. That will not happen. Actually, in the matter of fact, in Surah Al-Isra, the people of Quraysh, they want to, you know, challenge the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, give us miracle that you make all this Mecca, subhanAllah, in a garden and do this and do this, or you will have like a house out of diamonds, or if you go up to the sky, you ascend to the sky, and we will not believe in you till you come down with the book in your hand. قال أو يكون لك بيت من زخرف أو ترقى في السماء ولن نؤمن لرقيك حتى تنزل علينا كتابا نقرأه. We will not believe till we see when you're coming down from the sky, we'll see you holding a book to give us to us to read. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to his prophet? He tell them, we're going to give them the miracle? No. Because this is not a religion that is relying on miracles. We don't do things with miracles. You do things with your effort. You do things with your work. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in you the power, put in you in the engine. The miracle is the iman, the faith that you have in your heart. Look at the companion, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim, and the story, you know, they are beautiful and noble and great stories. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى said to his prophet, قل سبحان ربي إن كنت إلا بشر رسول. Say, you know, Allah is exalted. I am only a human being, a messenger human being. I cannot do all what you ask of me. So he said, up to you. You have the mind, you have the intellect. What I'm telling you is the manifest truth. But if you don't want to believe it, this is up to you. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring you a miracle, if you do not believe in it, then you're going to be destroyed and ruined and corrupted and punished. So the believer, one of the things that we have before, you know, igniting the tawakkul in your life, to get rid of any awham, like illusion or thinking that you think that is going to help you when it's not truly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not, as a believer, think that a miracle is going to happen or some sort of destiny is going to change my life to make me a rich person and at the same time pious and at the same time having everything. That does not work. It does not work. And this is the believer. That's why the next point in the tawakkul, you say the tawakkul for us, for what reason? What is your reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for? Are you relying for Allah to get more income? That's wrong. Are you relying for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get more of the thing that you ask in Him? That's also, it's not the right way. Yes, we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have the income. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guaranteed to you the provision. Therefore, what is our reliance for? The Prophet, the Messenger of Allah in Surah Ibrahim, they make for us very beautiful distinction as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. So when there are people, they told them, you know, you are only human being like us. Why should we believe in you? Why should we change our religion because of you? I mean, what you're saying, I mean, anybody else can say it. At least bring us Sultan, something that evidence as a miracle. Look what they said. And this is very important for us because the messenger here, they make the line of demarcation between the characteristic of the human being and the characteristic of the divine. قَالُوا إِنْ نَحْنُ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Yes, we are a human being like you. We don't have any extra power. We don't have superpower. We don't have anything of that. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put His favor and bestow upon His favor upon whom He will. So that's from the characteristic of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He choose you, He has the absolute will. Then, قَالَ وَمَا كَانَ لَنَا أَن نَتِيَكُمْ بِسُلْطَانِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And we cannot provide for you any miracle except by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the line of demarcation. A human being, we are weak by nature. We don't have the ability or the power to bring miracle. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you great power, which is in your heart. If you activate it, as we have said, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, you can be 1,000 times stronger than any other human being. But we are not asking to be 1,000 times. We're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us be stronger in our path, stronger in our struggle, stronger in our striving, which you have the key. Therefore, what is the tawakkul for? The tawakkul for on Allah to help you be firm on the deen. Whenever actually you do, whatever actually you do, you're going to make tawakkul. So what is your tawakkul for? Ya Allah, I'm relying for you to help me be strong on my deen, to help me preserve my deen. That's only the thing that you need to think about. If you do such a thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fix all your issues. All your issues will fix them. Look what they said, the messenger. قال وما لنا ألا نتوكل على الله وقد هدانا سبلنا. Why should we not, put the trust and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He guides us our way, when He guides us. ولا نصبرن على ما أذيتمون. And we're going to be patient on whatever you do for us. You're going to be patient on persecuting us. We're going to be patient on you hurting us. Ask yourself, why this messenger didn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save them from these people? Because all their focus is for Allah preserve for them the guidance that He honored them with. Yusuf alayhi salam, look, he was subhanAllah seduced and put in the prison. He didn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save him. He only asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save him from falling into the obscenity, into the fahisha. Why? Because he wants to be firm on the path of Allah. Because that's the most valuable in the life of a believer. So when you make your tawakkul for Allah to help you be good, to help you have khushu', help Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make your reliance on Allah to help you be preserving and maintaining your deen. That's the real tawakkul that the Prophet alayhi salam is teaching us. That, Yusuf alayhi salam, in his story, you can see all along his story, all what he is eager for is to be firm on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you do such a thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will activate the power in your heart to help you get faster and more secure and safe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُ وَالْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. بسم الله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى أما بعد. نوح عليه السلام after 950 years of doubt, he asked Allah one dua. This one dua, it didn't really fit the system of creed that Nuh was calling for and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught and revealed to Nuh عليه السلام. He asked for his son to be saved when his son was a disbeliever. And subhanallah, to make the point here, your trust in Allah is to help you be firm on your deen. That's the trust, that's the reliance. And Nuh alayhi salam, all these 950 years, standing for the sake of Allah. And you know in the story of Nuh, and especially if you read the ayat from Surah Nuh, how much striving he has done, and how much difficulty he endured with his people. And all what he asked Nuh in all this journey, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help him fulfill and convey the message. But here Nuh subhanallah, the love of a father is very hurtful to see one of his son that he's going subhanallah is drowned. So he said, Ya Allah, maybe when you told me, he was thinking to take with you your family. Actually, my son is my family, but he's rebelling in a way. Ya Allah, my son is my family. And you have promised me, وَأَنْتَ أَحْكُمُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. But the answer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was, very strong. And there is no compromise in the deen of Allah. That's what we need to understand. That's why our tawakkul need to be focused on us being on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firm. قَالَ يَا نُوحُ إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ. He's not from your family. What he has done is wrong. And I warn you to be from the ignorant one. It's very, and do not ask me something that you don't have knowledge with. In this dua, Nuh finding himself threatened that all his deeds, He's a prophet. He's one of the greatest messenger of Allah. One dua, not in his place, in its place. Nuh feeling like threatened to lose all his deeds. He turned in repentance, begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, I seek refuge with you to not do such a thing. Ya Allah, if you do not forgive me and shower me with your mercy, I'll be from the people who are losers. And this is to help us, dear brother, respected sister, to understand some of the deep concept in our deen. Therefore, you say, how can I nurture and how nourish and strengthen this ibadah of tawakkul who's going to help me have stronger salah and stronger sabr? It is you nourish it from your gratefulness to Allah on the guidance that He gave. Because if Allah guided you, you have to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided many millions of people. And you're being guided. Then your gratefulness to Allah on that guidance is what is going to help you to be eager to maintain the guidance. Then your trust and reliance will be on being firm on the path of Allah. And the first level of tawakkul, say, how I'm going to try to tawakkul, you know, to really understand it and implement it in its, you know, right concept, its right definition. They say, subhanAllah, how I'm, you know, working on the iman that I have in my heart. Did you meet your iman? Did you ask your faith what the faith in your heart is capable of? Now, the first level of tawakkul is to work on it before getting outside to standing for the truth and to call for this and to do, subhanAllah, things of striving that more serious. The first thing is to do it with yourself. The first thing, how can you defeat worrying and anxiety with the light of tranquility, which is part of the iman? Iman itself is named safety, security, peace. So why we do not have peace? That's the tawakkul. Ya Allah, I'm relying on you to help me with the light of tranquility embedded in iman to eradicate and remove worrying and grief from my heart. Ya Allah, I'm relying on you to help me with the light of freedom embedded in iman to liberate myself from the chain of the desire and the chain of the magnetic field of this earth. Ya Allah, with the light of justice inside the iman, embedded iman, I'm relying on you to help me face and remove and counter the transgression that I'm doing within myself. Ya Allah, with the light of certainty in the iman, help me, I'm trusting and relying on you, Ya Allah, to help me eradicate and remove doubt from my heart. This is the tawakkul. You see, dear brother, respected sister, the dimension of the tawakkul is totally different than what people think. And this is, when you are on this path, then the salat is going to have another taste. And the sabr, which is going to be the foundation of subhanAllah, or the fuel of the engine of the power in your heart. Wallahi, you become totally different person. And they finish with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ to connect all the dots to see how much the Prophet ﷺ teaching us to always think of our guidance, to always evaluate the guidance and regard it as the highest thing and the best thing in our life, and to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, invoking His help to keep for you secure and keep safe the guidance for you in your heart. The hadith, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deen. This is one of the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ used to do much. Oh, the one who turns aside the heart, make my heart to be firm on your path. That's the tawakkul. That's meaning of expression of the tawakkul. For may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us ignite in our heart the tawakkul, the patience, and make the salah to be true, the core of our system and the backbone of our deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to multiply the power in our heart, to be closer to Allah, to work better in the path of the ihsan, to find strength into the struggle of all these problems that we have in this life, and to not fall into the materialistic world when they do not regard such power in the heart except the people, what they have, toys in their hand or money in their banks. But you as a believer, you have a power, you have the miracle of yours is what you have inside you. You can ignite it and activate it with the worship that we have said. For may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to gain us and give us the firmness on the path. Allahumma ij'alna min ibadika al-mu'mineen, al-muttaqeen, al-mutawakkileen, al-sabireen. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana ajma'een. اللهم آتي نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم توفنا برحمتك مسلمين وصل اللهم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وآخر